Hi, everyone. Welcome to the National Alopecia Areata Foundation's webinar, Preparing for Back to School, Insights from a Teen and Young Adult Panel. Joining us today are some of our finest NAAF community members and volunteers who are now using their life experiences and struggles to help others navigate life with alopecia. I'm Judy Williams, Support and Education Director for NAAF. Before we start the webinar, I would like to cover a few housekeeping details. We have disabled chat for this webinar session, so please post questions for our speakers in the Q&A section, and please keep your questions general for the benefit of other audience members. This webinar is being recorded, and all registrants will receive a link to the recording via email. And finally, please share your feedback with us. At the conclusion of the webinar, a link to a short survey will pop up in your browser window. Please complete the survey there. This webinar is part of NAAF's You Are Not Alone Education and Empowerment webinar series, and NAAF is very gratefully acknowledges the support provided for the webinar series by our partners, Eli Lilly and Company, Pfizer, and Sun Pharma. I'd like to start today's program by telling you a bit about NAAF and our mission. The National Alopecia Areata Foundation is the leading advocacy organization for alopecia areata. NAAF's mission is to support research to find a cure or acceptable treatment for alopecia areata, support those with the disease, and educate the public about alopecia areata. NAAF's vision is an empowered community with the choice to embrace or live free of alopecia areata. To learn more about NAAF support resources and research and advocacy activities, or to join us as an advocate or a supporter, please visit our website at naaf.org. And now on to today's webinar, Preparing for Back to School, Insights from a Teen and Young Adult Panel. We are very pleased to have Maggie, Harris, Ernie, Ezra, Laura, Kenna, and Ian join us today. Thank you all for being here today. I will stop sharing and turn it over to you all. We'll start with each of our panelists giving their name, age, state, school, and age where they were when they were diagnosed. Ezra, if you can start, please.
Hi, my name is Ezra Key-Cohen. I am an incoming freshman going to Wesleyan University in Connecticut. Right now I live in Texas, and I was diagnosed with alopecia universalis at the age of 11. It's now turned into alopecia areata.
Thank you, Ezra. Kenna?
Hi, everyone. My name is Kenna. I am 20 and I'm from Colorado. I'm going into my third year at the University of Denver, and I was diagnosed with alopecia when I was 2 years old.
Thank you, Kenna. Laura.
Hi, I'm Laura. I'm 22 and I currently live in Boston, and I'm a master's student at Northeastern, and I was diagnosed when I was 5.
Thank you, Laura. Ernie?
Hi, everyone. I'm Ernie Kaye. I am 21 and a rising junior at Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. And I was diagnosed with alopecia areata when I was 15.
Great. Thank you, Ernie. Harris.
Hi, everyone. My name is Harris Roach, and I'm 23 years old. I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and I work at Zoom in cybersecurity. And I was diagnosed with alopecia when I was 12.
Thank you, Harris. Ian.
Hi, my name is Ian Liu. I am 16. I am a junior at Portola High School, and I was diagnosed with alopecia areata, now universalis, when I was 11.
Thank you, Ian. And Maggie?
Hey, I'm Maggie Brown. I'm from Virginia, but I go to school at University of Colorado Boulder, and I'm going into my third year. I was diagnosed with alopecia areata, which turned into universalis, when I was 15 years old.
Wonderful. Thank you all for introducing yourselves, and thank you again for joining us in this great webinar. We're going to start with some of the questions that we received from registration. And our first one is, how do you deal with questions from parents and other kids when you don't want anyone to know you have alopecia? How do you deal with the teasing? Is there anybody who would like to jump in and answer this one? Did anybody have to deal with teasing? Maggie, I know you've mentioned that before with some of your mentors.
Yeah. So when I was in high school, because I got diagnosed when I was 15, and that was like my freshman year of high school, and I had a group of boys that would call me spotty. And this is also a time when I was a little bit vulnerable, but I wore like bandanas every day to school. And I kind of just decided to pursue like positivity with it. And the more you smile makes other people smile, and it kind of just brings that light throughout the day. But that kind of just what got me through high school. But it definitely is a tough time, especially with the interesting personalities that go along at that age. But yeah, that was kind of how I, you know, personally pursued it.
Great. Anybody else want to add? Ernie.
So I also was diagnosed when I was 15, and I was a freshman in high school as well. And it was in the second half of freshman year. And I was definitely teased at the beginning of my alopecia diagnosis. There was this trend going on called notching, where people were notching their eyebrows. And it was like this truth or dare game that people, and everyone in my school was doing that. And so I started losing my eyebrows, and people were asking me what was going on, if I was notched. And I said, no, I don't know what's happening, because at first I didn't know that I had alopecia. And then I got back to school after spring break. I knew that I had alopecia, and my hair started falling out pretty quickly. And the thing that I did that helped me the most was really establish a support group amongst my best friends and my parents and my brother. And I really figured out that the more I talked about what I was feeling, whether or not it was positive or negative, if people teased me, being able to speak about that experience really helped me. And the more I opened up, the more I think that benefited me throughout high school.
Great feedback. Thank you, Ernie. Ezra.
So as I said, I was diagnosed with alopecia when I was 11. So I was going into sixth grade, like middle school. And I went to a different place for middle school than most of the people from my elementary school went. So I didn't really know anybody at all. And I got alopecia like a week before school started, and like all my hair falls out. And it was like the worst nightmare it could have been. And I get there and I start meeting people. And the thing about middle school boys is middle school boys don't really know how to react to what they don't know. So, you know, the first reaction is just to be like, I'm not going to talk to you. And so, you know, I think definitely when you're working with, like, if you're at a younger age and you're working with alopecia, a lot of your job is just to try and make people understand what you're going through. Because, you know, I think the first reaction is, oh my God, do you have cancer? Oh, I'd like, you know, pity is kind of the first thing that comes up there. And like, you know, a lot of what I would do in those situations where I felt like somebody was either like, you know, they said something that was hurtful or like mean, I would usually just be like, oh, like, let me clarify, because usually they're kind of working on something else. Cause nobody, you know, when you're that young, most people in general, even adults, don't really understand what alopecia is to the greatest extent. So just being, you know, like lighthearted about it and being willing to like, you know, bounce off of it a little bit, understand that it isn't always really meant to like, you know, tear you down. It's like coming from a place of misunderstanding. That always helped me.
Great. Thank you for sharing that, Ezra. Maggie, I think you had one more thing to add.
Yeah. Just kind of going off of what Ernie was saying, I definitely started small. Like I would have like little like friend group hangouts. And that's when I started to kind of like take off my bandana. And it was like more of like a confidence growing thing from that point. But just like starting off small with like a, you know, close trusted group of friends. And then eventually I like went to school with no hair. So that was kind of the little small building steps to get to that point.
Great. Thank you. I'll go on to our next question. So how would you help a teen, or what would you tell a teen who's having issues with self-image and confidence?
So what I did was I used to wear a hat. And so I would take like little steps. I would tell like a few friends, or I started with my family, and then I told a few friends, and I told my coaches. And so I think a good way to help build confidence is just take little steps, and then once you get those little steps down, you can start telling more people on your own accord. And yeah, that's how I would build confidence.
Great, thank you. Anybody else want to add anything?
I'll add to that. So I think another way to build confidence is really just to do what's comfortable for you. So when I had alopecia, when I was in middle school, I always wore wigs because that's what was comfortable for me at the moment. And now I'm comfortable without them. And when you do things that you're not comfortable with, it definitely like doesn't help your confidence at all. So definitely, I would say do that.
Great addition. Yes, Kenna.
I feel like confidence is, it's an interesting topic. I feel like you'll hear people say a lot, like fake it till you make it. And I didn't used to think that that works, but it honestly really does. I think confidence ultimately does end up being a decision at some point. I know when I was going into middle school, kind of like Ezra, like middle school is not the nicest, they're not the nicest group of people usually when you look different. But I think I just made this like conscious decision that I was going to fake it till I made it. And I said, I'm going to walk into school with my, you know, my chin up, my shoulders back, and I'm just going to play confident. And I feel like eventually, like nobody else bothered me because I, you know, was coming off as really confident. And then I feel like somewhere along the way, you really do sort of like develop that confidence for real. Like it's something you just sort of adopt in your day-to-day life. So it works.
Great. Thank you. Then I'll move on to the next question. Kids questioned me last year about wearing a wig. I wasn't sure what to say, and I'm not ready to share my story to everyone. What should I say when people ask if I'm wearing a wig? Would anyone like to add to that? I know it's multiple questions, so I can we can split it up, maybe if that's helpful. So, if the, for those of you who started wearing a wig and you weren't prepared to tell everyone, those times that they did ask you, what did you do or what did you say, Harris?
Yes. So I wasn't comfortable telling my story either, but I kind of just developed like, I guess, a script for myself, and I would just explain kind of, I guess, like what alopecia is, and that it was just something very private to me and that I just wasn't comfortable sharing it.
Great. Okay. Anybody else want to add to that? How many, I guess I'll have people raise their head. How many of you are wearing wigs? Do you still wear wigs out in, you know, to school or to the store? Any of you do that? Yeah. And some of you are pretty comfortable where, you know, you don't have to wear a wig. So that's good to know. And before we move on to the next question, I just want to remind our attendees, if there's any questions you may have, you can still submit them through our Q&A. The next question is, how did you share your story for the first time? Laura, I think this will be a good question for you. I know growing up, you have a really interesting story, how you started sharing this when you were in, you know, like preschool, wasn't it? Like elementary. So I'll let you answer that.
So I lost my hair pretty rapidly. It was between kindergarten and first grade, like that summer. So similar to Ezra, kind of going into school or like leaving school with hair and then going into school with completely no hair. It's kind of a tough thing to share. So got pretty good at like a little presentation at the beginning of the school year. My parents and I would kind of go and talk to the teacher before the school year started. And then like to like the kids in my class, we'd kind of do a presentation, like what is alopecia? Like, I'm okay. This and that, like if you have any questions to just ask. And I thought that was always very helpful. And then kind of as I got older, something that I found to be helpful was like doing like small little presentations or like roping it in with like a fundraising. Like my high school was really into selling pins. And so we like did a little fundraising and sold pins to create awareness. So just like those things are helpful as well to share your story.
Great. Anybody else want to share anything?
I can share something. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure NAAF has a video on their YouTube that's like supposed to be sort of like an educational tool on what alopecia is about. And I know that because I was in that video when I was like 3 years old. It's definitely from a while ago when I was a little baby, but they have a video that's supposed to be educational and it's just sort of like breaking down some of the myths about alopecia. So I don't know what it's called, but hopefully we could, I don't know. I know it's on the YouTube, so hopefully we could get that video out there, but maybe, you know, sharing that video helps, or if you're doing presentations for school, having something like, you know, this video, so you don't have to do all the talking, is kind of helpful.
Wonderful. Yes, Maggie.
So one of my mentees does this, but this girl named Rosie, she's with NAAF. Her mom created a book that was like When My Hair Went on Vacation or something like that. And my mentee Caroline, like her, I think her mom kind of shares that around. And when I coached gymnastics for like 6 years, and all the little ones just like didn't really understand what was going on. So to kind of teach them, I would like read them the little book, like on our break times and during like snack times and stuff like that. So when I was in high school, people kind of just like knew me as the bandana chick until I fully went bald. But I think when I first kind of like came out of the alopecia closet was like over social media. So I feel like definitely it's the sign of the times of things that are going on now, but it kind of differs for like age groups.
Great. Ernie.
Yeah. So two things that I did kind of in conjunction with each other. This was towards the beginning of my diagnosis. The first was expressing myself and my story through my artwork. I've always loved photography, and I was fortunate to actually meet probably 10 people with alopecia, kids and adults alike, in a photo project I did for my junior year or sophomore year in high school project. And I made a book with just showing people's faces, and everyone would dress differently. Some people were more vulnerable than others. And that's kind of, so I presented that at my school. It was on the walls at school. And I had some self-portraits in there too. And people saw me without hair. That was the way I kind of expressed that feeling, which looking back on it was interesting. I'm just now realizing actually that I did that. That's how people found out that I had no hair, because I wore a hat every day. So that was fun, I guess. The second part was through fundraising for NAAF. And I came to NAAF when I was first diagnosed, and NAAF was extremely supportive in every way, shape, and form. And we launched a fundraiser for the youth mentor program. And that was another way I wrote an appeal, and I was able to share it with almost everyone in my life. And my parents helped me to advertise myself and learn how to market Ernie. And that was really excellent, just to be able to share my story and why I wanted to raise money. And that really, really helped me out.
Great. Thank you, Ernie. I'll move on to the next question. And before I move on, if you want to jump in, if I didn't see you wanted to add something, please feel free to unmute and jump in case I miss anyone. I do have another question. It's, my 12-year-old daughter is diagnosed with alopecia areata and is losing her hair rapidly. She's worried that she will look different by September, the first week when school starts, and none of her friends know it yet. What advice or tips would you have for her? Laura.
So I was pretty little, but kind of going in, I remember like the first week or two, it was like, oh, like, who's the new girl? And I was like, it's just me, it's just Laura. And I think, I remember like towards the beginning, or like going into the school year, like right before it started, I kind of like met up with some of my friends and told them, and so like that was easier to help the transition. Having like a small support system, like even having the support system with your family and at home, having something in school, either like having a teacher that they feel really comfortable with, or like some friends that they know, I think helps ease that transition in case there is an instance of something happens at school and it's like, who do you run to? Where do you go? I think having a support system is helpful.
Great. Yes, Ernie.
One thing that might sound obvious, but I think it's important to remember, is that with alopecia, when you have alopecia, it's much easier for other people to notice. Everyone has an insecurity, especially teenagers and young kids. So if people make fun of you, that's probably because it's rooted in something deeper for them. And remembering that you're not alone in having something different, and it's okay to look different. People have family issues or other, maybe other diseases that aren't, or autoimmune conditions that you can't really see on the outside. And it's just important to remember that, I think.
Great, thank you. Maggie, I think, or Harris, right? I think you raised your hand as well.
Yeah, I was just gonna add, cause I was in the same situation. All my hair fell out in the summer and I was like, oh gosh, when I go back to school, I'm gonna look so different. How am I gonna handle that? And to be transparent, I bought wigs that resembled like the hair that I had to start out with. And for me, that was just really comfortable. And then the same thing that Laura was saying, just telling a few of my really close friends and having that support system was also really helpful too.
Maggie, I think you wanted to add something.
Yeah. We were actually talking about this in the local support group in Denver, like 2 weekends ago. And, not only is it like important to, you know, like find support and like kind of find your little crew, but also just like getting the school involved as well. A lot of like my mentees, their parents will go and they'll get like either like a 504 plan or something like that, where they have to have like a specific person, like a member of their little support group in each of their classes, or, you know, some other like accommodation just to help out, just to ease like the social anxieties of going back to school.
Great feedback, thank you. Our next question is, were any of you in sports? If so, how did you handle having to wear head covers or other coverings to protect from climate or sweat? And did you how did you communicate this? Ian?
So as I said, I used to wear hats, and so I used to wear hats, and so one time, before a race, since I do cross country, I told my mom like, hey, I think I might just take off the hat now, and so like I just like put the hat on the floor, and I just went running, and I remember like my teammates were cheering me throughout the race, and then like they saw me running by like, and they're like, is that Ian? So I think that was pretty funny. That's just a bit of a side story. But now I just wear a headband that just goes all the way around my head, and that just keeps the sweat out of my eyes.
Great. Thank you, Harris.
Yeah, so I played a lot of sports, and my parents would not let alopecia like stop me from living my life and playing sports. So for every sport we played, we had our own like specific things. So for example, for swim, when I wore a swim cap, my parents ordered me a swim cap that had like a band that attached to like the bottom of your chin so it wouldn't come off. And that was super comfortable for me because I didn't have to worry about my swim cap coming off and my wig coming off with it. So that was great for swim. For soccer, I wore headband wigs. So they're just like synthetic wigs with the headbands attached to them. And that was great because all the other girls wore headbands, so I kind of fit in like that. And even like with roller coasters, when I would go to like Six Flags or other amusement parks, my parents bought me a hat that had a strap on the bottom, so I didn't have to worry about my hair falling off then too.
Great. And with that question, Ezra, I'll also add this too before you answer. Maybe you can help with this too. How did you communicate with the coaches? Did you communicate before, or how did you handle that? I'll let you answer.
Okay, so I can kind of speak to two different experiences with this. So when I first got alopecia, I had alopecia universalis, so I lost all of my hair. And at the time I played, like kind of in that period, I played football and ultimate frisbee, and both of which are outdoor sports, some of which require, you know, like head equipment. And so definitely one of the first things that I did that I would always recommend in any sport is just having like a towel. Like, honestly, it's one of those things that you just don't like think about until you're out there. And I would always like, there was like a few weeks where I would just be like, man, I need a towel. And then I got a towel and it made everything better. That's definitely one thing. Just have a dedicated towel for that. And then another, like, and also, you know, as far as coaches, best thing is really just to go from the start and be like, hey, this is my situation. You know, oh, like maybe my head gets uncomfortable in the helmet sometimes, like, you know, just kind of communicate how you feel about it. Coaches are always going to be understanding. Just explain what the condition is and what you need. And then now that I have alopecia areata, you know, since I still have a lot of patchiness, I play soccer. I'm a goalie. And so like my hair sometimes needs to be pulled back or something, and that can reveal a lot of the patchiness. And so for me, one of the things that helped was maybe getting like a headband that has more coverage so that you feel like, you know, a little less exposed. And then, you know, another thing that helped would just be like not thinking about it, because you're playing sports. At the end of the day, people are not looking at your head. People are not looking at, you know, wow, that kid's hair looks weird. They're trying to like perform. So, you know, just let yourself enjoy that space and don't think too much about how you look.
Great. Thank you, Harris. And we got a question on our Q&A board, and it's about swimming. So since you mentioned you were in swimming, they're actually asking specifically about glues who are possibly waterproof, how to take off a swim cap without the wig coming off. Did you have any experience with that maybe you can give some feedback?
I didn't really use glue when I was doing swimming. I used tape. And I think the tape it's not waterproof, but it stays on long enough so that you can take the cap off without the wig coming off with it.
Great.
So I've definitely looked into the wig tape for sure.
Thank you, Harris. Did anybody else want to add anything? All right, I'll move on to the next question in our Q&A. Do you have tips for getting motivated for the day when you are feeling self-conscious or down about your alopecia? Maggie, you're the first one to raise your hand.
I actually saw this question earlier and I wanted to answer it. So kind of just like getting into growing confidence and feeling motivation. I was talking about this earlier about like faking it till you make it, and like faking it until you believe it, and then you can kind of show out. And when I was in school, I was kind of like, showed confidence, but you know, like when you are behind closed doors and you're in the privacy of your home, like allow yourself to kind of feel those emotions, because I definitely struggled a lot with like self-image. And I remember, this is kind of just a quick little story, but I remember I would sit and I would honestly cry in front of the mirror like every single day. And I would look and I would be like, oh my gosh, like, because I lost my hair over the span of a year, and then it grew back and then it all fell out again. But in that year, like it grew, like fell out so slowly that I would like be like, oh my gosh, I wish that I just had what I had a few weeks ago. And it just like kind of took like the mindset change to realize that like, oh my God, in like 3 weeks, I'm going to miss what I have right now. And kind of just being like grateful for the moment. Like a lot of like my friends, like when we go out and I have like those like little subconscious moments, like they'll be like, nope, look in front of you, like the mirror, and say 5 things you like about yourself. And kind of just like getting those like little building blocks to help you feel good about like going out and showing yourself to the world, because it can be a lot when you do look different. You are on like kind of a little bit of a platform when it does come out to like being in public, because you do get a lot more attention. But just kind of staying true to you, allow yourself to feel those emotions, and keep taking the small steps to build up.
Great. Thank you. Anybody else want to add anything to that? Okay, well, this next question, I'm going to put everyone on the spot. So, because I think this is always such a great question that I hear parents a lot of times want to know this. Is there anything you wish your parents had said to you? So I'll give you a little bit just to think about it and then see who wants to dive in first. Ezra.
So I'm going to kind of twist the question a little bit, but I kind of feel like I wish sometimes my parents had done a little less talking, a little more just like existing with me. Cause like, you know, it's very easy to get caught up in trying to comfort somebody by telling them, oh, like you look normal or everything is normal, but it isn't. Like it isn't normal. Like things are off, you know, this is a new thing and it's hard, or like, you know, it's and not everything's great. And so like, you know, what I would say is like, just give your kid a hug, or like, you know, if you know somebody, just like if you're the kid, go give your parent a hug. Cause like, I know for like young boys and stuff, it's really hard to talk about it, but it might be easier to just like, you know, actions over words.
That's wonderful feedback. Thank you. Laura.
Yeah, kind of going off of that. Like when I was five, but I kind of wish that my parents, I guess, since it was so quick, they wanted to do everything to fix it. And I think in the shuffle of it all, it's kind of like, I was like a little 5-year-old and everything's new to me as well. And so I think like, if I could go back, I would tell my parents like, hey, it's okay. Like, it's okay. Like, we'll figure it out all together, one step at a time. Like, it's, you know, kind of breathe for a second and then we'll do things kind of at my pace or at your pace. And I know it's also hard for parents. I think it's hard for everyone involved. So I think kind of going at everyone's pace is the best thing. Yeah.
Thank you, Laura. Kenna.
I agree. It can totally be super difficult for parents. And this is actually something I feel like my parents did a good job at. So I guess we'll go with that direction. But I feel like there's something to be said for, if you're a parent, like intentionally making space for yourself to be able to like process through what your child is going through, but not necessarily always doing it in front of them. Like, I feel like, you know, if you're constantly, it's not to say you shouldn't feel through your emotions, you should, but maybe not like constantly crying or panicking in front of your children, making them feel like if you make them feel like it's something that they should be crying and panicking about, or you make them feel like it's something that's a burden, then that's how they're going to feel. So it's like, process those emotions on your own and make sure like to in some way sort of decenter yourself from it and make sure you're like focusing on your children, as opposed to necessarily like making it about you, but still taking the time to process it just on your own.
Thank you, Kenna. Ian.
So to add on to the I don't think any parent should do this, but don't make your child seem like what you have is like insignificant, because my mom said like, oh, it could be worse. You could have cancer. And just like, that did not make me feel good at all.
Great addition. Thank you. Maggie.
We kind of talked about this a lot on the panel that happened at the NAAF conference, but my mom, I love her to death. She's a wonderful human being. But when I first got diagnosed, like her big like jump back was to kind of figure out everything and, you know, go into like the problem solving like mode. And it really kind of, we all agreed that it made us feel like there was a problem to fix rather than us just being us. And every single like appointment that we had, like Hannah was saying that like she was not having like support for herself or like letting her have her moments, she would cry at all my appointments. And I'm just like, girl, like we gotta get our stuff together a little bit. But just like finding your own support, because like the more that you help yourself, you can help out your child. That's gonna be like the biggest thing in the long run. But yeah, just definitely like supporting rather than throwing a billion treatments that are just complete shots in the dark most of the time, then, you know, just like being there for your kid and being a good parent.
Thank you, Maggie. Ernie.
So shout out to mom and dad. They were so perfect throughout my diagnosis and the years following. I'm sure they pissed me off at some point, and it was probably annoying back to them. But we were a really, really good team, and my parents allowed me to just talk to them. And if they had questions, they would ask me. If I had questions, I would ask them. If we were researching which medicine to take, which doctors to meet with, how to fundraise for a particular cause, whatever it was, I had my parents' support. If I needed to be left alone when I got home from school, I was left alone when I got home from school, whatever it was. And then a special shout out to my dad, who actually shaved his head when I was losing my hair. So I had a bunch of hair in the back of my head, but lost all of it from here forward. And if I could go back, I would have shaved it all off, or at least maintained it and not let parts grow and then the other parts just be totally hairless. So my dad shaved his head to motivate me and encourage me to finally make the change, which I never did. I got really lucky during COVID when my hair magically grew back. But having that kind of support where my dad, who'd never been bald in his life at the age of 50, shaved his head was pretty amazing. And I am very thankful for my relationship with both of them.
Thank you, Ernie, for sharing that. And Harris.
Yes, I would say to follow your child's lead. So not so much as something you should say to them, but just doing what they're comfortable with. I really appreciate my parents because like whenever I wanted to wear wigs, they just, you know, let me wear wigs and they helped me find how to like, you know, do makeup for my eyebrows. And they just kind of let me lead that. And they didn't really force me into anything. So I would definitely just say, let your child take the lead and just support them in whatever decisions they decide to make.
Thank you, everyone. This was great information to share with all of our parents. So we'll move on to the next question. How can I help my very shy 10-year-old son gain confidence so he'll take off his hat and start playing sports again? Anybody want to take that on? Ernie.
So this one was tough for me. I played baseball in high school and I was playing a lot of center field and right field. And in practice, I would just be in the outfield and coaches would hit ball after ball after ball. And the hat that we wore for school was too big for my head. It was a fitted cap that came in small, medium, large, but each size was somehow like I was like a schmedium and I couldn't figure it out. So I got a hat that was the same logo. I think it may have been a Utah hat or something. It looked like my school, but it was a Velcro on the back. And that's when I talked to the coach about what was going on. And once I had the confidence to wear that hat, because I knew it wouldn't fall off when I was running, I was able to gain confidence in actually doing my job in the outfield and not worrying about my hat falling off. Because I think Ezra mentioned this earlier, when you're playing sports, no one cares about what's under your hat, like literally no one except for you. And I think the reason why it hurts so much having alopecia is because you kind of dig yourself into this hole where it's like, why me, why me, why me? But no one else cares. If anything, people want to help you, like my coach did when I told him that I needed to wear this other hat. So finding an alternative, I think, and Harris mentioned this, with her cap, it all just depends to each their own. And there are many different ways to cope, but finding something that's comfortable is always the most important.
Yes, Ian. Thank you, Ernie.
One thing for gaining confidence, what I did is like, I made alopecia seem that it's not bad as it actually is. Like for Halloween last year, I dressed up as Kaye and everyone frankly loved it. Everyone just wanted to take a picture with me. And yeah, you just make alopecia seem better than it is. It's not a detriment to you at all.
Great answer, Ian. Maggie, did you want to add something else?
Yeah, so I did gymnastics like my whole life. And honestly, like the biggest confidence grower was my teammates. I fell back on them a lot because, you know, your teammates see you through everything, like blood, sweat, and tears. You like work your butt off with them and kind of changing not only like, oh, I'm balding, I'm doing all of this, like this is going on in my life, but I would just kind of show like, oh, like this is like an artistic, you know, way I can express myself with like my floor routines or like things like that, and kind of just like changing the connotation on it. But I definitely know the nerve-wrackingness of it because like you get weird deductions for things in your hair. Like I would wear like these like really big, and I was losing my hair. Like I would wear these like really big hair pieces so that they wouldn't, like my bald spots would be covered. And I remember like judges would be like, what are you doing? And I'm like, no, I can't do this. We're good. Like, it's fine. But like just falling back on your team, your teammates and your coaches, and just like knowing that this is something that you love to do and not like, you know, not let the other bits of it get into your head.
Thank you, Maggie. We'll go on to our next question. What is something I can tell my middle school daughter when she's feeling ugly and when she doesn't think she's beautiful, which she totally is? But yes, I'm having trouble finding the right words. Maggie?
I still struggle with this sometimes. Like, even when I was getting ready today, I'm like, oh God, like, why is my skin like this? Or just like, you know, everyone has their little insecurities. And a big part of it with me is there's this woman named Molly Tuttle. She's awesome. She's a singer. And she would talk about like the bad self-esteem days. And just like knowing that like, it's not something that we have to like change. It's okay to feel bad sometimes about yourself. And then knowing that life is never going to be consistent. You're going to have the lows, you're going to have the highs, and just like really just staying true to yourself and being like those little reminders in the mirror that my friends would be like, no, Maggie, like change the mindset, just like flip the page, really, really helps.
Great. Harris?
Whenever I feel like not super confident, or I feel like ugly or whatever it is, especially like not wearing the wigs anymore, I've just tried to fall in love with just being unique. And that's honestly like, I think the biggest thing that's helped me is just like, oh, I'm unique. And like, I just thinking about all the positives that alopecia has to bring, because there are some, and I found a lot of silver linings with it. And I try and focus on those when I'm not feeling super confident.
Great, thank you. I'll move on to the next question. How did you all handle the growing in and losing and the losing hair cycle? Did you just let it do its thing, or did you get to a point where you just kept it cut? Ezra.
Okay, so for me, as I said, my hair all fell out, everything, when I was first diagnosed at 11. And I started doing treatment, I think it was with squaric acid. And for the first few months of that treatment, it looked like it was really working. My hair started growing back. It was much shorter and it was a different color. Like, my hair grew back blonde, even though I had brown hair before. It was a whole weird thing. And it looked like it was really going to work. And then a few months in, it all totally fell out again. And I was deeply upset because I was like, oh my God, like, you know, it can work and then just choose not to work. Like, it's not about the treatment, it's about me. And after a few more months of that treatment and it really not doing what I wanted, I was like, oh, I'm not going to do this anymore, because I think I need to, you know, kind of come to terms with what's happening to me. And then, you know, I can look at treatment after that. And so there would be little bits of like, you know, you'd get a little fuzz and then it'd go away. And I think really a big part of, you know, becoming comfortable with it for me was just like, not paying attention to it. Like, you know, in the morning I would stop looking like, oh, did it grow? Is it different? And then also just honestly, when, you know, it would grow back a little bit, if it grew back too much, I would just shave it, because it would be like, you know, it's a little bit of a control thing. It's like, I can, you know, I can still, you know, keep a uniform appearance and I don't know, keep myself in a place I want to be.
Great. Thank you, Ezra. Anybody else want to add anything? Kenna.
Yeah, I'll hop in. So I was diagnosed when I was 2, and I was diagnosed with universalis. So all my hair was gone. And then miraculously, like before kindergarten, I wasn't on any treatments. It just grew back. And at that point in time, this is the early 2000s, they knew virtually nothing about alopecia other than that it is alopecia and that it makes your hair fall out. That was pretty much it. And the one thing that they did know is that it's inconsistent and it's unpredictable. And so I had hair for like a good 8 years, but I feel like, you know, I always had to be reminding myself, and my parents always had to be reminding me, that even if you have hair, like, you still have alopecia, it doesn't go away. And so I had to keep it in the back of my mind that it was always a possibility it could fall out again, which isn't a super fun thing to think about. But it was the reality. And I think that did help me prepare a little bit when it fell out again. I know for me, like, when my hair started falling out again in middle school, it was in, you know, big patches. And I think it was just like that in-between phase of, I didn't, you know, have a full head of hair, but I also wasn't bald. I feel like it was that in-between phase of trying to hide it that was so stressful for me. Like, I always view that as probably the worst and lowest part of my whole alopecia journey, was just the trying to hide it and the not knowing what to do. And so I know for me, even though I knew it was a possibility, that was a really stressful time in my life. And I know I just reached a breaking point where I didn't like the inconsistency and I just wanted to take back the control. So I just shaved my head right before I went to summer camp. And for me, it's like, that was kind of the only way I could try and find some sort of control with a condition that is unpredictable and a condition that you really just can't control. So I don't know, that was sort of my breaking point. The stress of hiding it was a lot. So I feel like it was super, super empowering to shave my head.
Great. Thank you, Kenna. And you can still, we have a little bit more to ask more questions if you want to submit questions. Here's our next one. How do you feel stress plays into alopecia? I seem to lose my hair more around stressful times, for example, during my finals at school. Maggie.
Yeah, so I've definitely seen how a lot of factors kind of play into my alopecia. Like my diet, I changed my diet and I had peach fuzz. I lost my hair over the course of a year and then it grew back after I did, it was this thing called PRP. I did a bunch of other treatments, but that was just like the one that made it grow back. And then I had two deaths that were kind of close to me in my life. And within like 2 weeks, it all fell out again. So I definitely feel like stress like plays into that because you're like stress like heightens your immune system and definitely plays into a lot of other factors in your life. But for me, that was kind of what showed, like when I'm like, okay, like if my eczema is freaking out and my eyelashes, my eyebrows are falling out again, like I just like know that like something's gone wrong. I'm like, what do I need to do to like calm down my nervous system just a little bit? It's just like an indicator at sometimes.
Thank you, Maggie. Anybody else? Ernie.
I feel like it's definitely very different per person. For me, when I started losing my hair, it was at a pretty stressful time. It was for me, at least, it was when I started playing baseball and I felt a lot of pressure from different people, especially the head coach of my team. And so that's when all my hair started falling out. I was also a freshman and there were a lot of older people. I felt self-conscious about my abilities and whatever. And then as my hair continued to fall out, I just noticed that even during the summer when I, like there were some summers where I wasn't really doing much and I wasn't really stressed, my hair would still fall out. And then I'd be really stressed at times and then my hair would grow back and then I would lose it again. And then during COVID, I was on Xeljanz, which I'm sure a bunch of people are aware of on the panel today. But I took Xeljanz and my hair grew back. And now whenever I'm stressed, I can still feel it's an intangible feeling almost where it's like, you're trying to Maggie was saying, like you try to calm yourself down because you can almost feel it coming out, even though it's not literally falling out when you're sitting down or walking around, but it's just the weirdest feeling. So it's all about just trying to maintain composure. And again, and I know I said this earlier, but making sure that you speak to people about it, because the more you speak and the more you're willing to open up and not hide it, whether physical or just verbally, I think it makes a huge difference just to communicate.
Great. Thank you, Ernie. We'll move on to the next question. Examples in your life of the positives or advantages as a result of alopecia. Harris.
Okay, so I have a YouTube like podcast channel, and I just recently did a whole episode about this, so I kind of love this topic. But one of them is that my routine in the morning is super quick and super easy. So I work from home, so like I can practically like get up and be ready like as soon as my workday starts, which I love. I love the low maintenance of it. When I go to the gym and I work out, I get compliments all the time, like, wow, it must be so easy for you just because, you know, you don't have to worry about your hair getting frizzy or dirty when you're sweating and things like that. And, yeah, those are just a few.
Thank you, Harris. Maggie.
Definitely the community appeal. I didn't even know what alopecia was when I got it. I had no idea NAAF existed until Molly introduced it to me. But I became a mentor, I think 4 years ago. And that completely changed my life. It like completely changed my trajectory. It made me realize like my purpose in life of like wanting to help people. And like now all of my little ball babies are the reason that I wake up every day. So just like that community appeal and just like finding hope in those like everyday life situations, and also just like being like a walking learning platform. Like everyone, I love like the questions of like, please ask me, like I want to like educate people as much as I possibly can about like autoimmune diseases and how it's okay to look different and, you know, going out in the world and making some sort of difference. That's kind of what alopecia has done for me.
Great, thank you, Ezra.
Honestly, this is a very real thing for me, but I feel like alopecia is just the greatest like perseverance and humor developer on the planet. Cause like, I feel like before I got alopecia, I didn't really have as strong of an identity almost. Like it forces you to really like, you're like, okay, I'm really lost on my physical identity. So I really have to nail down the rest of it. And so from a very young age, you have to look at yourself and be like, who am I going to be? What am I putting out there? Because, you know, people are already going to look at me and just create this version of me. Now what I have to do is be like, okay, I'm going to give you a full version of me from the first second you talk to me and make sure that you understand that my appearance tells you nothing about me. And so like, you know, it really forces you to face a lot of things a lot of people don't face until they're like in their like late 20s when you're like 12. So it's, you know, some people look at that and they're like, that's really sad. But I say, you know, it's just, you know, you figure a lot of stuff out earlier when other people are struggling. Now you're like, I got that.
Awesome feedback. Thank you, Ezra. We'll go on to our next question. Have you ever had people stare at you and how did you handle it? Ian.
This actually happened to me a few days ago. I was getting some food with my family, and there's these two people that are staring at me. So what I do is I just stared right back until they looked away, and like that usually gets them.
Great input. Thank you, Ian. Laura.
Yeah, I've never really worn a wig, kind of like off and on when I was younger. And so kind of like people staring, it's something that I guess I've gotten used to as I've gotten older. But it's kind of funny, like meeting new people or like going out with friends, they notice more than I do. And I think that's always an interesting conversation. Like sometimes they bring it up and they're like, hey, like people stare in public, like, does that make you uncomfortable? And for me, it's like something that I don't even notice anymore. But I think for them, it's more like, I'm okay. Like I'm okay if like, you're okay type of thing. And I do think like at school and stuff, like I know growing up, like kids can ask questions, kids can stare and kids can be mean. And I think like in a more controlled setting, like school, addressing those things and like maybe talking to someone about it or kind of being like, hey, like I have alopecia and like, this is what it is. Kind of help that. And those like awkward interactions of like, going on can help. So
great, thank you, Laura. Maggie.
It definitely took me a lot to like get used to the stares. I remember the first time I went out when I was like, I shaved my head and I was junior in high school, that's like when I fully lost everything. I was like, oh my god, everyone's looking at me. And it took me a while to kind of like own it and be like, okay, everyone's looking at me, like it's good. It's like, you know, but kind of going off what Laura said, like my friends notice it a lot more than I do. Like whenever I go out with my friends, people are like, you get so much attention. And I was like, yeah, but like, I mean, you just get used to it. But for me, like, especially concerts or cities or some things like that, like kind of looking above the crowd, like rather than, you know, getting into it or like just like smiling back at people really just like shows people that you're not just something that looks different. You are a person, and, you know, just like having a normal interaction with that.
Thank you, Maggie. This next one first says, thank you to this great panel. I have a high schooler who was diagnosed at age 3. She's very strong, but it's very hard, and she has been bullied. How to handle depression and anxiety associated with alopecia? Ezra.
So I think that the first thing I'm going to say is just the obvious is just therapy is very good. And I was very hesitant to go to therapy because there is a lot of, you know, it's just stigma around it, especially, you know, for men and just young, like, you know, you just grow up and you kind of get this idea that like, oh, if I go to therapy, I have to have a problem. Like there has to be like something wrong with me. But you know, therapy is helpful for everybody. And when you're going through that change, like, you know, we talked about earlier, like a few of the other panelists have said, you know, it's kind of tough when your parents are sitting in that room with you and they're also crying and they're also struggling. And the doctor is also like, hey, I don't really know what's going on. And your friends are kind of like dicey and sometimes they can feel a little rude or like they don't know what's going on. So having that therapist there, somebody who's a third party, who's, you know, trained, and, you know, who isn't as emotionally tied to your situation can feel nice because it's like a break from all the high emotion, high intensity, like very real, serious stuff. And you can kind of just approach it however you need to.
Great. Thank you. Kenna.
Maggie sort of said this earlier, but I think it's important to allow yourself the space to feel through it and feel what you need to feel. I feel like I appreciate my parents always approached alopecia as like, it is a loss and it's okay to like grieve that loss, even if you've had it for a long time or you're just now losing your hair. Like if you don't allow yourself the space to feel through it and say, I'm actually not okay right now, then you're never going to actually be able to process it and get to a point where you feel okay with it. So the first step is just accepting it and allowing yourself to feel it.
Thank you, Kenna. We are almost out of time, but we have two more great questions that I'd like to add. So we're going to go a little bit over, we may go over a little bit of our time, but the next one is, this is a similar question to earlier, but any suggestions on how to respond to my 4-year-old daughter who has been saying I look like a boy and seems to be upset about it? Laura?
Yeah, I think that was also kind of something that I was growing up with. I was like, I don't look like any of my friends. I like feel like I look like, look in the mirror and you're like, who is that? Cause you don't recognize yourself anymore. And I think something that kind of helped is like changing the narrative of like, what does that mean to be a girl? Or like, what does that mean to be a boy? Or like, what does that mean to be you? I think is kind of, I guess everyone has kind of touched on this is like, that it doesn't become your identifying feature. And I think that becoming whoever your kid is or whoever you are is the most important part. And if alopecia is a part of that person, then that it should be something kind of embraced and looked at it as not something like a fortune, but kind of something that it's happened and you kind of have to deal with it, which is good and bad sometimes.
Thank you, Laura. Anybody else want to add anything else? Okay, I have one more question, and this may be for, I believe Kenna was diagnosed at age 2, so this might be more for her, unless anybody else wants to add. I have a 2-year-old who has alopecia. Do you have any memories of how it felt at that age psychologically? Seems the parents are having a harder time than my client.
I don't remember being 2 necessarily, but I do remember being a little kid and being bald. And I think if it's any relief for parents, when you're 2, you really don't care. I mean, like little kids ultimately, really, like you care about who can run the fastest on the playground. Usually little kids don't actually care what you look like. So I feel like I cared about it way less when I was, you know, 2, 3, 4 than when I was in middle school. And it probably was harder for my parents at that point in time. I know they had a lot of anxiety about, you know, what is my life going to look like? Is our daughter going to grow up and get bullied? Is our daughter going to get bullied, you know, this year? But if it's any relief, you know, you don't really care about it when you're a little kid, but also, you know, look at all of us, like your kid is going to end up okay. Your kid is going to probably end up great, like any one of these speakers. I guess that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add? anything else? And that was our final question. So if you have any last comments you'd like to add, I'll let you do that.
I can say something real quick. I kind of said it earlier, but just like getting support for you. I don't know if the majority of the population on this is parents, but I'm thinking that it is. So just support yourself and know that everyone is on their own journey. Everyone's going to be feeling their own things at certain times. And that, again, like Kenna said, like in the end, everything's going to be okay.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add one last thing before we wrap this up? And we were getting a lot of comments, and we got a lot of comments as well during registrations to thank you for being in this panel, that you are all amazing. And we do want to thank you for this great feedback and this advice that you've provided to our community members. So to wrap it up now, I'm going to share my screen again. I think everybody can see it now. So thank you all for being here today. We really would like for you to share your feedback on this webinar. It does help us plan for future presentations. So a link to the short survey will pop up in your browser window at the end of the webinar. And your feedback is appreciated. And NAAF is excited to announce the inaugural walk for alopecia. So join the Alopecia Areata community for the walk on September 30th. We will rally coast to coast to raise funds and support our community, educate the public, and empower people living with alopecia areata everywhere. You can walk in San Francisco or create and join a team to walk in your area. The walk for alopecia will bring the alopecia areata community of family, friends, coworkers, and healthcare professionals together. So we will have our walk kickoff on Thursday, August 24th. So join us to learn more about the walk. And there will be a drawing for those in attendance. So please go visit NAAF.org/walk for more information and to receive a link to join the kickoff. And save the date, join us for our next webinar, The Connection Between Allergies, Zima, and Alopecia Areata in Adults and Children, Implications for New Treatments. A large population of the patients who have alopecia areata also have allergic conditions like eczema, asthma, hay fever, and food allergies, or they may have close family members with similar conditions. This presentation will cover how alopecia areata and these allergic conditions can be related and what it implies for treatment options. Our speaker will be Dr. Emma Gutman-Yasky from the School of Medicine at Mount Sinai in New York. This live webinar will take place on Wednesday, September 20th at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific. Registration is now open at NAAF.org/webinars. And don't forget, NAAF offers a number of resources and programs to the alopecia areata community, including support groups, our youth mentor and legislative liaison programs, as well as news and webinar links and how to get involved. To learn more about NAAF and the resources we do offer, please visit NAAF.org or email us at support@NAAF.org. So this concludes today's webinar. Thank you again for joining us, and thank you to all of our panelists. We look forward to seeing you on the next webinar.